Make sure you watch until the end to see how you can win free gear and products. Hey everyone, this is PJ with CLK Supplies, and I am here with my dad, Pete. Dad, thanks for coming back on.
Yeah, no problem.
So a lot of people have been asking to kind of see your operation.
Yes.
And so I figure we would start here at your headquarters.
Right.
How long have you had this store for?
Since 1990.
1990, okay. And how many square feet is it?
3,300.
So we're standing in your showroom right now.
Yes.
And I kind of want to have you explain kind of what went into the thought process, the mindset of what you wanted to put in here and what you wanted it to look like.
Okay. Well, I wanted to display keys so the customer could see you cutting the keys instead of turning your back to them as you cut the keys. Our first shop up here was 220 square feet. And this is like a bowling alley, but you know, we sell a lot of safes, so I wanted to bring those in, need room to put those, display the merchandise out front instead of keeping it in the back.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, that's how I figured. And I want every key I can ever get.
Yeah.
From the 94 Ilco book, I did all those, or 84 Ilco book. That's how I did my board from A to Z.
You just went through the book and
put every tag on, and you can still see there's a few not there, but we pretty much got them all.
Wow. Okay. So you set up the key display here, which we'll show everyone
okay.
in a minute.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like a sandwich shop.
Yes.
Right? So I remember as a young kid, so this is the shop that I actually learned locksmithing in.
Yes.
Cut my first key, rekeyed locks.
Right.
All right, Dan knows what we'll do is let's go ahead and hop behind the counter here.
Okay.
And I'll have you kind of explain, you know, the machines you have, why you have them, and kind of how you have your setup back there. And then we'll move in the back. We'll show the workspace.
Okay.
We'll show the dispatching room.
Right.
And then your office.
Oh, great.
So, all right.
Okay. Come on back.
All right, Dad, so you can see here, you know, of your glass piece right here so people can watch, you know, which is, by the way, always fun when you're trying to get the key clamped down and it keeps kind of moving around and the customer's looking at you like, are you going to be able to get that done?
Isn't that the truth? Or they flip out for some reason.
Or they flip out, yeah. Now, so you have a whole bunch of machines here. How many people do you typically have working up at the counter during a typical day?
Two?
Okay. And if you're gonna take me through here, so it looks like I see we have, starting at this end, we have like a Ilco 045 speed.
Yes.
We have a Futura, we have a Flash.
Yep.
And then it starts to get kind of old school on us over here.
Absolutely.
This buffer, I mean, you know, this is where I learned to cut keys, right? This machine actually right here is the machine that I used to cut keys when I was a kid.
Yep.
Same with this buffer. Where did this buffer come
from? I got it at an auction. I liked it because it was on its own stand and put a deburring wheel because I don't like using the deburring wheel on the machines because it wears out your bushings that much quicker.
Okay. And so is this the original motor here or
yep.
have you replaced that?
Nope. That's
really?
The original. I replaced the off and on switch.
Yep. Okay. Now, right here we have, you know, the machine I learned on, and you know, has a little light switch here.
Yep.
You know, it just shows that, hey, you know, when everything else is good but the switch, you're not gonna throw it away. You're gonna figure out a way to fix it.
Nope. You're right. I'm gonna recycle everything I can to make everything work.
Yep.
Be profitable.
Absolutely. And then we have a older Ilco machine, kind of like a, looks like a 044.
Yep.
And then we have your 1200 Blitz.
Yes.
So you really have, you know, what I really like here is you have from like really old to really new.
Right.
All in a row here.
Right.
I also noticed that you have some keys up front here in bulk, and then you have a ton of keys obviously on the wall.
Right.
What made you put some keys up front here and other keys on the wall?
Well, like the Y1 or the Y1s, KW1s, SC1s, the Do Not Dupe Schlage, you know, BE2 Best, the popular automotive. We put in bulk up there because the peg only holds 15 to 20 keys and it's gone every day. So it's better to have your bulk so you can leave those up as your backup if you need them.
Okay. Now underneath your bench here,
yes,
you have some shelves that have a whole bunch of other keys. So talk to me. Yeah, talk to me about why they're there and kind of the methodology you have behind it.
Well, you always need backup stock, and I hate running out of anything, because sometimes even myself or the employees forget to write it down on the order sheet, and you go, oh my gosh, you know, I just could have sold 50 whatever, you know, KW1s, and we only have 20. So that's why we always have hundreds of backups.
Yeah.
And stuff. And, you know, when I buy out other lock shops, I split all the stock in between the three stores and have good backup.
Mm-hmm.
And keys we never had before, we get.
Yeah, and I think it's something interesting. You know, most of the time you buy keys in boxes of 50,
yes,
right? That's how I prefer to sell them to you anyways,
yeah,
right? And if the peg only holds 15, 20 keys,
right,
what are you gonna do with the other, right? And
right,
so to put it underneath here and have it available,
organized,
and have, you know, what do you put a Sharpie on there? You hand write in big letters what it is.
Right, we have automotive, foreign automotive, then regular automotive up top.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have, you know, A through Z for, you know, the regular keys.
Yep. All right, Dad, so, you know, when I was a kid, up here cutting keys, and I'd be like, hey Dad, we're getting low on this key right here. What would be the first thing you would always ask me?
Did you check under the counter for the backup?
And how, you know, I can't remember exactly, you'd have a better memory than me. How good at I was that?
Not very. I go, no, here it is, and pull it out for him, or I would be out.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't a very popular key.
Okay. All right, Dad, next I want to talk about your keyboard, the key wall.
Right.
And I just kind of want to give everyone an insight to how you decided to set this one up. So if you can just kind of walk us through your methodology for putting it, the keyboard together.
Well, I went through the ILCO book and back in 84 and started writing on key tags from the front of the book to the back of the book of the North America keys.
Yep.
And hung them up, ordered them as I needed, or if I had a little extra cash, ordered them.
Sure.
So it goes from A to Z. Then we have our boat section, our Ford, our Chrysler, our GM.
Mm-hmm.
Because they keep adding, so it's hard to put a board without a couple spaces.
Yeah, so kind of up top here, you just kind of go exactly how the book goes.
Yes.
But then when you get a little further down, you start to kind of specialize a little bit. Like here's the RV keys.
Right.
There's the boat keys.
Right.
Right. And then on the far wall there, you have all of the automotive keys.
Yeah, the foreign automotive. That's the foreign automotive motorcycle specialty, you know, colored keys, Kwikset, Schlage, and Weiser.
Yep. And you even now... Today, now, so the board is set up to by the X number, right?
Yes.
By the Taylor X number,
right.
X1 through X, I don't know, 280 now,
yeah,
60,
something like that. Yeah.
Now, even though you order it by the other number half the time, right? Like a TR-47
right,
is a X217.
Right.
Right, but you still found it beneficial to set it up by the Taylor number.
Right, because years ago, that's what was best known for, Taylor, until ILCO bought them. But we still put the TR-47 next to the key blank, so, because I like the easy number, it's easier to remember than a big long number.
Sure. Now something really unique that you do is when you're done cutting keys, how you present them to the customer.
Yes.
And you essentially have two options, what I have in my hand here. You have like the free, like the giveaway, inexpensive key ring,
right?
And you also have these envelopes.
Yes.
Talk to us about why these are the options.
Well, the envelopes came about when I first started to get my name out there. And
okay,
so here they take them home, they have all three locations, your phone numbers, your addresses. Even if they, I only cut one or two of quick set and they're the same. I put them on a key ring because they have another quick set they want five of, but I still put them in the envelope because it's all about advertising, getting, keeping your name out there.
So to the best of your ability, when someone orders keys, you want them leaving actually in this.
Yes.
And you'll give them, you know, you'll separate them using the little giveaway key ring, but with this option, like if they want other sorts of key rings, you have them available for purchase, but you really want them leaving in these, in
these
envelopes.
Well, and I want them to buy the key rings. I don't want to give them a ton of these free key rings.
Mm-hmm.
I'd rather have them buy, you know, where we're making money.
Sure.
That's the reason I have a store. It has to pay for that brick and mortar.
Absolutely. Dad, we're back here in the workspace of the shop here. You have three workstations set up.
Right, my new ones.
Your new ones?
Used to be all the old plywood and wafer board and 2x4s, and I still got some on this side, but this winter we'll change them.
Okay, and you have it set up kind of like each individual workstation for rekeying, for working on essentially automotive locks.
Everything.
Everything. Everything. Now, you have these shelves above here that you keep a whole bunch of different pinning kits on. You, can you kind of talk about why you have
them? Well, I use the universal kit for 90% of everything, but if you have a cam lock, original Yale padlock, I use original quick set keys on every quick set lock, American Master, a lot of extra pins, because you always run out and you don't realize it.
Yeah.
And then the foreign automotive, domestic automotive, behind PJ is the foreign. And we have setup keys where we buy new locks, put them on the, you know, sell the lock, key it to their customer's key.
Yeah.
And then we keep the others for setup keys.
Okay.
Because there you make your money again.
Yeah. All right, now in previous videos, we've talked about key stamping.
Yes.
Right? That's something that anyone who's ever worked for you has had their fair share of stamping keys.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
Because you don't want a metal-headed key to ever leave
without our name on it.
Without the name on it, right? And so there's your jig right there. It's set up. It's, you've moved it off the bench. You can see the hole where it used to be from the constant use, and you have it on this like tree log.
Yeah, one of the guys, Javon, said, "Hey, it makes so much noise on the bench. I got these logs at home. I'll bring a piece in and set everything there." And you know, you barely hear it now before
Absolutely.
It rattled the building.
Absolutely, yeah. So there's where, I mean, that's the same jig I used as a kid. I mean, I think a lot of those extra dents on there might have come from
you.
Me.
But, you know, the one PJ sells, the new one he sells, this one I got from some locksmith I bought out, and I've rebuilt it up 50 times. But all the other shops have your jig.
Yeah. I might be able to cut you a good deal on a new one. You know?
Yeah, well, you know your dad. Tight. Okay, you know, here we have all our tools color-coded. Even in the drawers, this is the blue station. We have to share stations sometimes, but stuff gets disappearing, so you color code everything. This one's yellow. The one over here is red. And you wonder where your tools or your followers go. And before you know it, they're in the guy's trucks. And I'll keep buying. And they say, "Oh, I don't know what happened to it." Well, here they got to be accountable for. So that's the reason we do that. We have the eye, you know, helpers over there at each station. But it's worked out great. We just did this about a month and a half ago. I still got a lot of the rest of the shop to remodel work areas because it's cluttered. We have a lot of extra tools, but we don't need every day, but we're going to make an area for everybody to borrow them and put them back.
So you do a lot of safe work.
You're right.
Always have. You do a lot of refurbishing, selling brand new, selling used, and also openings.
Yes.
Now this one happens to be in here right now. Talk to us about what you have going on with it.
Well, this one, a customer came and says, "Hey, I have this safe to sell, and are you guys interested?" I said, "Yeah, what do you want?" He told me a price. And I said, "Well, for us to come down and pick it up, you know, that takes money too. So we settled at a price and I came and got it. He goes, well, I need it open because there might be some guns and ammo in there. I said, well, if I buy it, I own everything in it. If you want to pay me to open it, then you can have everything in it and I still keep the safe.
And so, it's sitting here. So yeah, did he choose?
Oh, he wanted his guns and ammo because it was his dad's or stepdad's.
Okay.
And because he passed away and they had the combo, but it didn't work.
Hmm.
So we opened it and we're fixing it. We're going to sand it and then repaint it, you know, because this is a nice safe with all the shelves inside.
Absolutely.
You know, this safe, you could sell for $2,000 easily,
mm-hmm.
you know, and your profit of used safes is pretty good because we go through everything, make sure everything's working. Where we had to drill, we made sure there was a pin and rolled pin and welded it in there.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, this one's nice enough, I might keep it myself.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is our dispatch center where we have Hallie and Janae. And this is where they receive all the calls out of all the shops. Then we dispatch them to the trucks. And if they need to talk to the shop, we have a back line where they call and the customer is directly connected to them.
Right now I'm in the back corner of my dad's lock shop where he had added on this space kind of below and above. And this is actually where I started doing CLK Supplies. So let's go ahead and head on up and I'll show you where it all started. All right, so here we are. So this is where it all started. As a matter of fact, these are the shelves right here my dad built years ago that I was actually using. And if you look up top here, you can even still see some of the old numbers. Like this is where the B44 keys were, and B16, B46. So although this is now used by my mom for something completely separate, these shelves, this space right here is where it all started for me. All right, and there you have it. Dad, thank you so much for taking the time to give everyone a tour of your store here.
Yeah, no problem. Hope it helped everybody who are thinking about having a store or what you want to stock, how you want to stock it. Everybody has a different idea. This is my idea. You guys probably have your own.
Yeah. Well, great, Dad. Thanks again. And we will see you next time. Since you just watched this video, I'm guessing that you work with locks and keys. And to us at CLK Supplies, that makes you a lock boss. And we want to hook you up. Here's how it works. Throughout the week, join the conversation and comment on our posts and videos and include the hashtag LockBoss. It's free to enter this giveaway. And every Tuesday, we're gonna pick 5 winners from the previous week and hook you up with all sorts of prizes, including gear, tools, supplies. We might even send you a key machine or buy you lunch. So if you're a LockBoss, join us every week to learn, grow, and win.